Hi, and welcome back to From the Heart and Desk of Pastor Rich. I'm so glad that you joined us for this episode, and I'm looking forward to getting into a little bit more detail about how we can fellowship in the midst of a pandemic. If you haven't yet, go ahead and subscribe to the channel so you know when new episodes become available. And if you like what you hear, hit the like button, share a comment, ask a question in the comment section. That feedback is really important and I really appreciate it. So thank you very much. Now, last episode, we looked at a biblical definition of what fellowship is. And even though the New Testament translate the word koinonia, which where we get our word fellowship from, in a number of different ways, what they all have in common and what we can boil it down to is the idea of sharing. And when we looked at what fellowship was that we had in Christ and how that happens, it's through the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And so he unites us with Christ. And so we share or fellowship in his suffering. We fellowship or share in his death, in his resurrection, in his inheritance, and later in his glory. And so what a glorious thing it is for our salvation to be united together with Christ in fellowship and sharing in those things. And so we want to take that idea of fellowship, of sharing, and bring it into what we're going to talk about today. Now, again, I want to leave this note with you all and keep this in mind, that the depth of what the Bible says regarding our fellowship together and our fellowship with Christ is just so immense. And I am going to touch on the highlights during the episode, but by no means am I saying this is an exhaustive study into the concept and idea of fellowship. And so I want to encourage you to use this as a springboard for your own personal study to really get into what the Bible says in regard to our fellowship with one another. So let's take that question first. As we looked at three questions last week, we looked at what is a biblical fellowship, and we fleshed that out in our union or in our sharing and fellowship with Christ, what that means for us then. And why, what we're going to look at today is why is that important for us as believers? And then thirdly, we're going to try and touch on today in this episode, how can we as believers fellowship with one another during a pandemic? So let's go to the second question there, our fellowship with one another and its importance. Now, our fellowship with Christ then brings us into fellowship with other believers. And that's illustrated to us in the New Testament in a number of different ways, a variety of different ways. Believers are collectively called the body of Christ. There in Romans chapter 12, you can look this up, Romans 12, verses 3 through 5. It says, "For through the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think more highly of yourselves than you ought to think, but to think so with sound judgment, as God has allotted to each a measure of faith. For just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another." So there again is that idea of fellowship and being united in Christ, being in Jesus. And what that means with other believers being in Christ is that we're members of one another. And so we have fellowship with one another. We who are many are one in Christ, individual members of one another. This another illustration that the New Testament gives for us as believers is that we've been adopted into the family of God. I love the book of Ephesians, the letter that Paul wrote here in chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy, blameless before him. In love, he predestined us to adoption as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him," that is in Christ, "we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us." So we've been adopted. And this was something that God planned to do in Christ before the foundation of the world was even set. I mean, that's a huge understanding to try to wrap your mind around. I also want to take you to 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 2. John talks about this in a different way. He says this in verse 1. He says, see how great the love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we would be called the children of God. And such we are. For this reason, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God. And it has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, that is when Christ appears, we will be like him because we will see him just as he is. Now, this is according to God's kind intention, that he lavished his love upon us, that we would be called the children of God. You know, John even talks about this in his gospel in the first chapter, that we are children of God, that Jesus, through Christ, we have the right to become the children of God. Believers are also called collectively now, and we share in this. So we share not only in our adoption, we share not only in being members of one another, but we share also in what Scripture calls the bride of Christ, that is the church. And we get called this at the end in Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 through 8. It says, John is writing here as he's seeing and he's experiencing this vision that God's giving him. It says, then I heard something like a voice of a great multitude and like the sound of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder saying, hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give glory to him. For the marriage of the Lamb, that is of Christ, has come and his bride has made herself ready. And it was given to her a cloth to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean, for the linen is the righteous acts of the saints. And so collectively, we're called to be members of one body, that is the body of Christ. We are called adopted members of the family of God. And so we fellowship in that way. And collectively, we are called as the church, as believers, the bride of Christ. And so we have fellowship with one another. As Christ is our bridegroom and the universal church being the bride of Christ, we can see how we share in this wonderful blessing and knowledge of who our Savior is and the love that the Father has for us. So why is fellowship then, this sharing, so important for believers? Well, number one, if we're going to look at this, is we've got to understand that we were created with a need for fellowship. You know, we looked a few episodes ago when we talked about worship. We saw that the Trinity, our God, who is one, expresses himself in three persons. And really, the Trinity gives us the perfect example, that perfect model of what perfect fellowship looks like. Jesus said this over and over in the Gospels. He would say, I and the Father are one, meaning we are one. We have the same mind. We have the same plan. We have the same desires. We have the same will. That sharing and that fellowship that he had with the Father is something that now we have as believers in Christ to the Father through the Spirit and then towards one another. The other thing we can look at too is that we are created in the image of God and we were created for fellowship. And we look at the first man and woman who were in the garden. Marriage pictures this. Family pictures this, that we've been adopted into family, that there's marriage that's taking place, that intimate relationship between a man and a woman called husband and wife. And really, the imagery from the New Testament really draws this understanding in that we've been created for fellowship, that we are the body, we are members of one another, that we make up the church, we are living stones being joined together to form this beautiful thing that God is creating in his church. And the reality is we were never really intended to be isolated from one another. I mean, 1 Corinthians 12 puts it this way. Paul writes, but God has so composed the body, that is the body of Christ, giving more abundant honor to that member with which lack, so that there may be no division in the body. He doesn't want the body divided from itself, but that the members may have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are Christ's body and individually members of it. And so when we look at the New Testament teaching about fellowship and being together and sharing, we do not understand from the scriptures the idea of being isolated or being apart from the body of Christ. We're all to be joined together, united in fellowship and sharing with one another. And it's in this context, it's in the context of fellowship or sharing that our gifts can be exercised. I mean, think about it. If there was no fellowship, if there was no gathering together, if there was no sharing with one another, preaching, teaching, training, all of those kinds of ministries that take place wouldn't be necessary because we wouldn't need to share with one another. But in sharing with one another, in fellowshipping with one another, we see these things at great work. And so that's why we are told in Scripture to gather together. When we think about also what the Scripture tells us in our spiritual development, our spiritual growth, that is the one another's of the New Testament. Now, I just want to give this little shout out real quick to encourage you that there are about 59 one another's that appear in the New Testament. Most of them have to do with love, but there's a great deal of others that are mentioned in the New Testament. And I want to just encourage you to go and take a look at them, really dig into them, understanding what they mean. Maybe we'll hit on these in a future episode, but until then, I pray that you would go and you would search those out to see what those mean so that you can share with one another and fellowship in that way. Now, we are commanded to gather for the purpose of encouraging one another. And I love the way that Hebrews chapter 10 puts it, this very familiar passage to most of us, and that it says in verse 23, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." And let us consider how to stimulate, other translations say, provoke one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as we see the day drawing near. And so as we're thinking about fellowship, as we think about sharing, we should remember that it's in the context of gathering together as people. Now, that leads me to this question, and may lead you to this question as well. How can we as believers fellowship during a pandemic when we're supposed to be isolated from one another or social distancing or whatever we want to call it? How do we get that fellowship or that sharing in? Now, gathering at a building made these things easier to accomplish and to carry out those commands, but in this day and age where we are at right now in the midst of a pandemic, these commands are even more important for us to try to follow. The fact that we have not seen each other or met together as we normally do as in the past doesn't mean that their importance and their priority have suddenly slipped away. We should be, as we just read in Hebrews, doing this all the more even as the day approaches. So then, how can we share with someone today? Be thinking about that. Is there a brother or sister in Christ that needs you to share with them? Is there some encouragement that you could give to someone? Is there some expression, that way that you can reach out and encourage another person? So I want to give you four ways that we as believers, in the midst of this pandemic, can fellowship with one another and sharing with one another. The first one is to express love to one another. Now, that seems kind of obvious, but the ultimate example that we have in Scripture of love is when Christ died upon the cross. But even before that, Jesus gave a demonstration of his love, a lesson of love to his disciples in John chapter 14 when he washed their feet. And so when we think about that act and we think about what Jesus did in his love for his disciples at that point in time, knowing what he was about to do, look at the impact that that act of love had on the Apostle John. In 1 John 3:18, he encourages us and he tells us this, "Little children, let us not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and truth." And so, yeah, it's very easy to say I love you to someone, but how are you expressing that? How are you showing that person? Let it be done in deed and truth. And I want to encourage you to do that as you think about how to go about your day and what to go and do towards someone else. He also writes in 1 John 4, verse 11, he says, "Beloved, if God so loved us, then we also ought to love one another." And that means doing something. Going out of your way. It's going to be, especially right now, inconvenient because we're not meeting at a specific location where we're going to see those things. It's going to take a little bit more work, but the priority of loving one another hasn't gone away. And I just want to encourage you in the first way that you can share or fellowship with one another in this time is to express your love to one another. Now the second one kind of goes along with that, and that's serving one another. Galatians 5, Paul writes us this. He says, "For we were called to freedom. We're free in Christ. We have liberty. But brethren, only do not turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, in the statement, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." So when we think about serving, what can we do? How can we express love? How can we show our love by serving others right now? Like I said, it's going to take a little bit more work than what we may be used to. But the reward for it, the encouragement that's going to come from it, is going to be an even bigger blessing, especially the one that we're expressing it towards. Number three, one that's always there, and I just want to continue to encourage you to do that, is that's pray for one another. Really take your needs, your requests, those things that you have personally, yeah, take those to God, pray for them. Ask God to intervene, ask God to move, but also praying for others. You know, we send out our bulletin each week, and on the back of the bulletin there is a list of prayer requests for our missionaries, for people in the church. And I just want to encourage you to take the opportunity to pray for them, pray for those needs, and to make, even if you have needs, make them known to the church so that they could be praying for you as well. Colossians, Paul writes this in verse 9 when he's talking about the Colossian church. He says, "For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, that is your faith, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will, with all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light." I just want to just encourage you, if you're wondering what to pray for your brother and sister in Christ, just take that and start praying for it. Can you imagine if there was somebody out there, how encouraging it would be if somebody was out there praying for you, that you would be filled with the knowledge of Christ, with all spiritual wisdom and understanding, that you would walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, that you would be pleasing to the Lord in all respects, that you would be bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, that you would be strengthened with all power according to the glorious might of God, that you would be steadfast and that your patience would grow, and that you would joyously be giving thanks to God the Father who has qualified you. Can you imagine if someone was praying for you in that way? What an encouragement just that would be. What an act of love, what an act of service that would be for some. And so for some of you, that is your gift, is praying. And so I just encourage you, pray for me. Pray that the words that I speak would come out and would be glorifying to Christ. Pray for your pastor. If I'm not your pastor, I'd love to be your pastor. But if not, pray for your pastor. Lift him up in prayer. Pray this prayer for him. He would greatly appreciate it. I know that there's brothers and sisters out there who need prayer. Pray this for our missionaries, that they would be strengthened and steadfast and faithful and all these things, because I know that that would encourage them. So when we think about it, how can we fellowship and share? There's three ways right there. Love, serve, pray. The last one I want to leave you with is encouraging one another. You know, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, Paul writes this, "Therefore, encourage one another and build up one another, just as you also are doing." I know many of you out there are encouraging one another and provoking one another on in good love and good deeds. And I want to just encourage you and push you on to keep doing that. If you haven't encouraged anyone throughout this pandemic, I just want to admonish you. Do it. Encourage. Go for it. And so these are four ways that we can fellowship together without having to gather together necessarily as a big corporate meeting. Now, we're searching for ways to do that. So stay tuned, especially those of you at Rockville Bible Church. There's going to be ways that we can start gathering together. But until that time, I pray that you take these things and put them into action. Let me admonish you in this way, to be as what James says, to be proven as doers of the word, not merely listeners. This is more than an intellectual study. I hope this is an opportunity for you to take, to step out in faith and worship God in this way through Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and put actions behind what you are studying and what you're learning here. I hope that this short study has whet your appetite for these things, for greater understanding of your fellowship in Christ, your fellowship with other believers, and how you can share in that fellowship with one another. Once again, I'd like to thank you for joining. As always, please subscribe if you haven't subscribed yet. Hit the like button and feel free to leave a comment or question in the comment section below. Now, in the next few episodes, we will look at putting these gifts that God has given us to use in the context of fellowship with our fellow believers. And so that's what we want to do and what it means to serve. And so we're going to look at what serving is. Now, we've gone through worship and we've gone through fellowship, and now we're going to look at what it means to serve one another. So until next time, may God bless you and keep you and give you peace in the name of our glorious Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray you have a blessed day and that you feel encouraged in the Lord to do good things. God bless you and have a wonderful day in the Lord. That you gave me the stars, put them out of my